A lot of pointed questions being asked about these confidentiality separation agreements that happened between not one, but three outgoing members of the Whitmer administration, in some cases paying them hundreds of thousands of dollars in pay and income and benefits, even though we were told it was a voluntary resignation. When she was asked about it, this is how she answered to the question, is it normal for you to pay someone who has resigned?
Separation agreements, to your question, are used often in the public and private sector when someone in a leadership position leaves an organization. And due to the nature of the agreement, there's not a lot more that I can say on this subject.
And isn't that convenient? We turn to Senator Jim Runstad, a Republican of White Lake, joining us, one of those lawmakers on the GOP side, raising some very important questions. Senator, good morning to you.
Good morning, Guy. Glad to be on.
I want you to tackle the first line of that soundbite. These are normal in the public sector, or common in the public sector. Through your research and the people you've talked to and the reading you've done, is that true?
That is not true. They are common in the private sector. They're very unusual in the public sector. The public doesn't like these cover-up, hide-the-trail, which is what this is precisely. And the comical part of it is when Gretchen Whitmer was a senator and Rick Snyder let his Treasury director, it was uncertain whether he resigned or was let go. I think it was kind of mutual. He ran into some personal problems,
right,
and he got a couple of months severance, and she said, this is a golden parachute. This is outrageous that he's being paid. And now, not a couple of months, but 9 months' pay of the top paid individual and the deputy, it stinks to the high heavens. And I think her, hiding out and making these comments to try to shift and misdirect is not going to work. She's in the hottest water she has ever been over her nursing home policy, and I believe that is what this is all about. She was one of four or five states that put COVID-infected patients into nursing homes with the non-infected. Anyone who knows how that works with the lack of proper ventilation means that it's going to spread throughout the facility. That's what happened in New York. And that was what we believe happened here in Michigan. We've been trying to get to the bottom of the numbers. The numbers reported to the feds versus the state are different. We're running into many of the same situations that happen in New York.
Well, you know, usually these things are used in those instances where you might get hit with a wrongful termination suit. So you pay the person off so that that doesn't happen. That's why they're used in the private sector. But in the public sector, especially with someone like Robert Gordon, he is an at-will employee. He can be fired for absolutely nothing. They don't have to give him cause for his termination. Now, they're spinning it that this was a resignation, but that makes it even more curious, because why would you have to have a confidential separation agreement and a $155,000 payoff for someone that's leaving voluntarily?
Yeah, the people are getting wise to her maneuvers. There is no doubt that this was done because he carried a lot of insider information that she wanted bottled up. And that,
but do you have evidence of that, Senator? I mean, you're speculating there, and I want to be careful about that because I don't want to besmirch this man's reputation either. Do we know that for a fact?
Well, he was the guy who was in charge during all of what she is now facing. And did she know that she was going to be facing this? My understanding is this was shortly after the situation blew up in New York City. There's just a whole lot of coincidental evidence. You're right. I haven't talked to him. I don't know absolutely that that was the reason, but I guess from all the coincidences that are coming together, it certainly has the appearance of that.
We know that he did have some family issues. His father died this past Saturday, and that was brought up as perhaps part of an explanation. But when you see a pattern of this, and this gets back to you, something you and I have talked a lot about, Senator, and that is you are an advocate for sunshine laws. I respect that so much about you. This has got to be something where you've got colleagues on the other side of the aisle singing out of the same hymnal that you are. Will we see in the Senate some FOIA reform legislation that will get through this time? The House has passed it before, and it's always gone toes up in the Senate. Do you think you'll get it through this time?
I think that there's a new wind blowing through Lansing. I think there's a very good shot at that. As you know, I have always co-sponsored and voted for that legislation. I will vote for it again here. And I think that there's a will here in the Senate to start cleaning up some of this toxic mess. And so I think that there's a very good chance that that can happen.
I want to just quickly get to a topic that you and I have talked about, but I don't know that the Paul W. Smith audience has done much on this, and that is the fact that members of the Michigan State Police had an encryption app on their phone that allowed them to text one another, and that those texts were not only just encrypted, but they were not logged or recorded through the state servers per normal procedure. You asked a lot of very thorny questions of the MSP. You wanted to know how many officers had this. Whether or not the governor's security detail had it, whether or not the governor had it. Do we know? Have you had answers to those questions yet?
No, we have not. We've not got those answers. We are going to be having another hearing in budget committee that oversees MSP, and we will be asking those questions in a very pointed way. We still haven't heard from the governor as to what her view is of these policies, but basically they were using an app that not only encrypts the information, but it vanishes. That's what it is sold as. It vanishes, and there's no record of this. So they're being sued right now by some law enforcement individuals who were terminated, mm-hmm. and they want their day in court, and they want this information that should be subject to open meetings, freedom of information. And they're being denied their day in court because of this app. This is exactly the kind of thing that the public is concerned about. And we're going to drill down and get to the bottom. How many were using this? It sounds like all the top people were using it. And how many people on down the line were doing it? How many situations have we had where individuals are interacting with the police, and maybe something occurred that we need to have transparency about, and it's all gone because of this app. So it's something we're definitely going to be staying on top of.
And are we also going to ask about whether the department heads and the governor, whether the executive branch may have been doing this as well? Because obviously it circumvents the normal record-keeping mandate that we have.
Yes, we are going to, and my office is looking at putting in a bill to prevent any kind of an app that can make the information disappear, that it has to go through proper channels and be retained. And it's a little more complex. I thought it would be simple, but it's we're going to get there, but it's just how we craft it is going to take a little bit of time.